Shalom, welcome to the Jewish View. My name is Rabbi Nachman Simon with the Chabad House of Dalmar, together with my co-host, Mark Ronich, who's been a reporter in the Capital District for over 30 years.
That's right. Thank you, Rabbi. And one of the people who I've met along the way is the former mayor of Schenectady, Al Jurczynski, who's our guest today.
Oh, excellent.
So welcome to the Jewish View.
I'm glad to be here.
And this goes under the heading of whatever became of.
Yeah, there you go. That's
so
right.
So you were mayor of Schenectady.
Which years?
Yeah, from 96 through 2003. I was the last mayor of the last millennium, the first mayor of this millennium.
And the last Republican mayor.
Oh, yeah, yeah. And prior to that, I served on the city council for 12 years, and I was minority member of the Schenectady City Council, and that kind of paved the way for me to have a successful run for mayor in 95.
Well, at least you had a minority party in Common Council in Albany. You know,
absolutely.
You have to be a person of color to be a minority
party,
and they're all Democrats.
Yeah, but you know, I wanted to always ask you the mindset, because like you say, Albany or Schenectady, you know, a person mayor, I mean, you know, you're an accomplished person and, you know, could do other things. And then just the constant...
The barrage,
the press is screaming at you, you know, nothing's... So what kind of job? You know, you do a job... Or maybe the boss, you get a one-time a riff with the boss. But here, constantly, an argumentation, you're no good here, and you're doing a lousy job. There, you know, there's always somebody. I mean, obviously, you have good people that love you. But on the other hand, just to hear that all the time, as well.
And, of course, they only say good things about you.
Well, no, not really. You know, something that's very interesting that I want to share with you is that... Being in the political arena, I happened to be very confident about what I wanted to accomplish. I lived in Schenectady my whole life. And, you know, one thing that people used to say to me, and it took me quite a while to, I thought it was some kind of conspiracy that they were all saying the same thing to me. People would come up to me and they'd say, you know, I can't say that I agree with everything you say and do, but I've never questioned your love for Schenectady. And it was so amazing because people used to say that to me constantly. And after a while, I you know, at first I thought it was, okay, the opposition, you know, they're setting me up, you know? but I came to appreciate that, because if you're in public office, who's gonna agree with everybody all the time? You know, they're not going to. But when they consistently said, we've never questioned your love for Schenectady, that was always nice to hear.
There was something that said, if people agree with you 80% of the time, that's a good thing. 100% of the time, they should go to the mental institution.
Absolutely. that's so true. That. And you know, one time I'll never forget, Dave Novak, who was on the council with me, you know, and it was after a city council meeting, and we were down the clerk's office, and we were just talking. And Dave said, you know, in the political arena, you got to understand one thing. If you can consistently, once you're in office, consistently keep 51% of the people with you, you're untouchable. You'll be in office as long as you want to be. But he said, but what's sobering about that is that you've got 51% that are in your corner, but 49% aren't in your corner. And but as long as you can maintain that 51%, and if you're in for 20, 30 years, you go from becoming a politician to a statesman. You know, because that's what happens when you're in office for a long period of time.
And one thing I wanted to ask you about, because I hear this all the time from friends of mine who were in elected office, it takes a toll on the family.
Yes, it does.
Especially from that 49% or the folks who are hammering at you, the media saying things that aren't necessarily true, but they think they're true, or how it's being twisted and connived and all that. So how did your family put up with that?
Well, you know, my wife, my in-laws are Italian immigrants, and my wife is 100% Italian-American. And, you know, she's... She's a good lady, mm-hmm. good yeah. wife, good mother. And we had two great kids, and I always used to talk to them and tell them, say, you know, there's an advantage to being the son or daughter of the mayor. There's also a disadvantage, too. You know, one time, I'll never forget my son Alex, who's now 26. It was shortly after I got out of office, and he was a senior in high school. He had the family car, and he was out until 1 in the morning. He comes home, and I said to him, I said, you know, Alex, I said, you were out until 1 in the morning with your mother's car. And I said, had you gotten in an accident, it would have been an article in the paper. Son of the former mayor gets in an accident. Whereas if one of your friends got in an accident 1 in the morning, no big deal. So I said, there's the good and the bad that comes with that. And I says, and you just got to be mindful of that at all times, you know.
And while this was at 1 in the morning, I say that nothing good happens after 2 in the morning.
There you go.
So that's right. Within an hour.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's good. And then your son, Alex, recently ran for office.
Yeah, he ran for city council last year, and yeah. knowing that he was going to be the turning 26,
And he was probably one of the best bets.
Oh, yeah.
That's we right. have two yeah. our.
Well, that was one of the.
Let me see if I could get it on.
You know what? I brought an extra one.
But if you see that, he couldn't stand politics if he went into it.
That's well.
If he discussed it, he wouldn't go with the politics.
He asked me. The opening came on the city council. And I asked. I read it in the paper, and I said to him, I said, Alex, you want to run for city council? 25 years old. He says, how much does it pay?
Yeah.
I said, $15,000 a year. I said, you got a couple meetings a week, you know, plus your health benefits. And I says, you're going to turn 26. You got to have your health benefits. Yeah, okay, I'm in. I'll run. So it was because it was a guy that resigned. It was a six-week campaign. It was very intense, and Dad was in the background trying to work the social media and everything. Yeah. And he did very well. You know, Democrats outnumber Republicans in the city of Schenectady 3-1.
Really?
And
but he didn't have to run for the whole city. I mean, it was just
it was citywide.
Oh, okay.
And. You know,
I thought they were districts.
This isn't Albany. This is Schenectady. It's all at large.
Okay.
So it was a presidential election.
Yeah.
Big voter turnout.
Right.
Alex got over 7,000 votes. His opponent got over 9,000. Mm-hmm. He raised a lot of eyebrows because they said, "Holy cow, that's the best the Republicans done in years." Mm-hmm. You know, so a lot of people wanted to run this year, but he's the head baseball coach at Hudson Valley. And they're scheduled to have a doubleheader today, but I don't think they're going to have it because of the
You're
rain.
A big baseball fan also.
I love the Yankees.
Also the Albany Dutchman.
Yeah, yeah. I do some marketing for them, you know. So if anybody, as a matter of fact, they're going from St. Rose to Siena College, where they're going to play this year. So, so that'll be kind of exciting. You know,
well, Hudson Valley doesn't use the Brewery territory.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Hudson Valley does use that, but the Albany Dutchman, that's a collegiate, perfect pitch league, and they only play during the summer.
Yes.
That's right.
I took my grandson there.
So yeah. Let me ask you, what was the highlight for you as mayor in the 8 years that you were there?
Just to interrupt, Mark. So it must have been a big accomplishment, what you're saying, putting two and two together. You say you're outnumbered Democrat 3-1,
mm-hmm.
and you're a Republican, and you won the mayor. So that must have been just
twice.
In itself.
Not just once, he won twice.
Yeah, so that was a real big accomplishment.
It was a lot of fun. Schenectady's got a tradition of putting Republicans in as the mayor. Frank Ducey was in for years, and they put me in.
But I think it's because of what you said earlier, and that people knew that you had Schenectady in your heart, mm-hmm. that you loved, they knew you loved the city,
yeah.
and the integrity, and the fact that you would do what's best, and you weren't an opportunist, you were doing it because you wanted to move the city along,
yeah.
you had that man on the street, Al D'Amato type of fealty.
Yeah, well, and you know, I grew up in Hamilton Hill. I came home from 3 years in the Army in 1977.
You grew up on Wiley Street?
Yes, and you know, when I was in the Army, I studied Russian out in Monterey, California, uh-huh. went through interrogation school at yeah. Fort Huachuca, Arizona, then I was stationed at an interrogation company in Fort Hood, Texas. And fortunately, a war never broke out. If a war did break out, you know, I would have been right there,
mm-hmm.
you know, and there's only about 600 interrogators Army-wide, and, you know, so...
So you mentioned your Russian, your skills in terms of Russian dialect.
Yeah.
But the Guyanese are what made you famous, right?
Well,
I heard a story.
That's... I'd like to say that, you know, that I made it, and I did make it happen, but there was a lot of luck involved.
Okay.
If
there wasn't, you would have been blamed, so take the credit.
Yeah.
I'll tell the story from the beginning.
Yeah,
I don't know anything about the story.
Well, I got to tell you, my birthday's November 18th.
Okay.
Does that ring a bell with Guyana?
You know what? No, I don't know.
That was the same day of the Jonestown Massacre.
Oh, really?
Which happened in Guyana. Yeah. But I digress. So you
Because of your birthday party?
But every time it comes up on Today in History, that's the Jonestown Massacre.
That was 1978, correct?
Something like that, yes.
Yeah.
But I digress. But it was the same country. So.
Well, anyway, Guyana. And let me back up a little bit before Guyana. Schenectady, when I was mayor, I always thought in the back of my mind, I didn't talk about it a lot, but always in the back of my mind, I saw what was happening. I saw people that I grew up with, Polish, Italian, Irish, Jewish, whatever. If they grew up in the city, they didn't stay in the city.
Mm-hmm.
They'd move to Rotterdam, they'd move to Glenville, Niskayuna. My generation, the baby boomers, didn't stick around the city. You know, our parents stayed there, you know, but the kids all grew up and, you know, built their homes in the suburbs and all that. And I always looked at what was left in the city, and I said, you know, we need an influx of new blood. And it's very interesting because when I worked for state government. Now, this was after I was mayor. Mm-hmm. Curious, Joel?
Mm-hmm. Sure.
You know, we did work with them when I was at the governor's office for small cities. But also, you think about the Koreans in Los Angeles mm-hmm. and ethnic groups. And I always thought that was kind of interesting. It was almost like Back to the Future. Like Thomas Edison founded GE in Schenectady in 1886.
Right.
And then in the early 1900s, people that came, Polish, Italian, right. Irish, you name it. And you could look at the Jewish synagogues and the Catholic churches that dotted the landscape of Schenectady. You could see where the ethnic groups settled in Schenectady. And I always thought to myself, I said, I'd love to get a group of Hasidic Jews interested in taking over the Albany Street Business District. And years ago, there was actually synagogues there. And a lot of Jewish merchants made up the Albany Street Business District. Well, then as time went by, it became Hamilton Hill. And, you know, it had prostitution. And how do you clean that up? Yeah, it's pretty difficult. But you get an ethnic group to come in. And this is where it was quite by accident, but Jay Sherman, who was my director of development in Schenectady, he comes to see me. He says, hey, he says, there's a guy I want you to meet. And so I went down to his office, and it was a guy by the name of Derek Singh. Derek is about my age. He's worked for Stewart's going back to the late 70s. He's Guyanese. And he told me the story, me and Jay, he says, there's a Guyanese population that starting to show some interest in Schenectady. And I didn't know if it was Guyanese, Guyanese, if it was Guyana, Ghana, you know, I didn't know, you know, just like everybody else. But Ghana's in Africa. Guyana is the northern edge of South America, right next to Venezuela. And it's the only English-speaking country mm-hmm. in South America. And it started out as a British mm-hmm. holding or yeah. colony, whatever you want to call it. And you know, and then a lot of the Indo-Guyanese, which are the basic group that came to Schenectady, they came over as indentured servants from India and were in Guyana. And then through this one little thing, you know, where Derek said, we're looking for a place to worship, a Hindu temple. Mm-hmm. And I told him, I said, we normally don't foreclose on churches or houses of worship because they don't pay taxes. Mm-hmm. And unless they abandon the building, we don't take it. Mm-hmm. And I said, at that point, 6 years, I said, there's only been one church that was abandoned, and the Seventh-day Adventists already scarfed that up, so I really can't help you out. But I said, why don't you approach the Albany Diocese? Because I said, they're starting to cluster mm-hmm. churches, and they may have a surplus of buildings. So I wished him well, you know, and then he did that. He went to the Albany Diocese, and he called me 3-4 months later. He says, hey, I took your advice, mm-hmm. and he says, we got us a church, mm-hmm. or a temple. Mm-hmm. I says, really? I said, which one? He says, St. Thomas's in Mount Pleasant. I said, oh, yeah, okay. It was an old German church. And he said to me, he said, I'd like to invite you to come by and, you know, meet with the congregation. So I said, sure. So this was in May of 2001. And I went there, and I met with this group of Indo-Guyanese, and they were just wonderful. You know, mm-hmm. they were very hardworking, industrious. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's how it started. And there was one elderly guy in the back, and there was probably about 30 people there. It was in the church hall. And one guy in the background, he says, we're Guyanese. He says, we help each other, and we don't believe in getting on public assistance. Well, that was music to my ears. So, you know, it was around that time, a group of Guyanese businessmen from Richmond Hill down in Queens came up in a limousine, and they set up an appointment to meet with me, and I had my key staff people there, and they came in and met with us, and then they extended an invitation for me to go down there.
Right, I remember that trip you took.
Yeah, and I went down. It became, that was one of many trips. Mm-hmm. And I became a bit of a celebrity down there, and the Guyanese were so overwhelmed. They said they couldn't believe that an American politician was paying attention to them. Mm. You know, they said in New York City, the only time you see the mayor is when he's driving by on the freeway, and his entourage.
Or if there's a Guyanese parade by in the neighborhood, yeah. or something, you know.
You know.
So when you went to did you ever go to Guyana?
Yes. Yeah.
You did.
That was.
You didn't drink the Kool-Aid.
No. Didn't drink the Kool-Aid, but okay. I did drink the El Dorado rum.
Okay. Well,
you know, the El Dorado rum. I should have brought a bottle of it. It's.
We'll catch up with you on that one.
Yeah. It's very good. Okay. It's the 15-year El Dorado rum with coconut wata. That's the way they say it. You know. 15-year El Dorado, and the El Dorado rum is from manufactured by Demerara Distillers out of Guyana. Uh-huh. It's the company is over 300 years old, and it's a very well established company, and you know, and El Dorado rum is considered one of the best in the world. So,
except don't say that in Jamaica, though.
No, well,
you know.
Yeah, I know.
That brandy and that rum, that's there.
Yeah. You know. but the Guyanese rum is excellent, you know, and when I was down there, the president at the time, President Jagdeo, he had a reception in my honor, you know, and the second day I was there, the front page of the Kaichor News, which is like probably the New York Times version in Guyana. Okay. You know, Guyana is a country of 800,000 people. And it said, U.S. mayor visits Guyana. It was a big deal.
Yeah.
And we went down there. We were down there for 9 days. And we watched a cricket match.
Was it printed in English?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So you brought, you have how many copies? Did you buy out the place?
No, I brought several copies back. They're boxed away, you know.
Oh,
but,
good. Okay.
But yeah, it was...
You should definitely have that on your Facebook page. I mean, just as a
I've put that on before, you know, and it was very interesting because in the 9 days that I was down there, on several different occasions, people would recognize me down in South America. You know, they'd come up and say, "Hey, Mayor Schenectady," you know, and it was so interesting. I remember, great. Yeah, so, it was just.
So, okay, so we're wrapping up, but I just wanted to say that after your tenure as mayor of 8 years, because, you know, you're 60 now, so you've been, you know, this is a short period of your life.
Sure.
And I don't want to spend all the time on this. It was difficult to say goodbye to the office, wasn't it?
And No, because you know what? Believe it or not, when I left, I was 47 years old. The luster was off the apple, let me tell you, you know, because as a matter of fact, I went to work for Governor Pataki.
Yes.
And it was so interesting.
Really?
That when I got over to the state, Friday would come along and it was like, what do I need me to do anything tomorrow or Sunday?
No,
go home. We'll see you Monday morning at 8 o'clock
and
or 9 o'clock.
And there's no work to take home with you.
No. And and I said, holy cow, this is what an interesting concept, like a mini vacation once a week, you know, because when you're the mayor, there was no such thing as time away, you know. And it was.
What were you doing for the state? What was your position?
Well, I was there for a little over 3 years. And the first year and a half, I was at the governor's office for small cities, which was a very small agency. But we did the community development block grant money,
right.
You know, which you have entitlement money and non-entitlement communities. And the entitlement communities are normally communities with 50,000 or more. They'd get the money directly from HUD. The rest of the money was about $55 million would go to this city and then go to our agency. Mm-hmm. And we would advertise, you know, among all the smaller communities.
But
Curious Joel was one of them. You mm-hmm. know, they would get money from us.
But this would go to pave sidewalks or?
A lot of different things. They could use it for public works projects, for human services, you know, for... police, okay. for law enforcement, you know, so it...
How many people does Schenectady have, going back to them?
Well, it was 62,000, now it's up to about 67,000 because of the Guyanese.
Really? That many people have moved in?
Yeah, well, it was the Guyanese initiative, and if you go on Wikipedia right now and look at Schenectady, the Guyanese are the second largest ethnic group in the city of Schenectady, second behind the Italians.
Oh, I thought behind the Jewish community.
No, well, you know, that's...
He says they ran to the ski unit.
Yeah, that's right.
But I just want... But right after mayoral, you did something with Metro Ford?
Yeah, that was only for 6 months, actually.
But it must have been the most fun thing you've done.
No, believe it or not, it was pretty tough because they had a lot of salespeople there. And you know, you were always...
You were Mayor Al.
I know.
You could have had your own commercial.
So some people would come in and they'd ask for me, but for the most part, you know. And at the same time, I was working in corrections out in Montgomery County.
Well, that's another thing I wanted to ask you about, because Rabbi Simon is a chaplain, prison mm-hmm. chaplain. So let's talk a little bit about corrections.
That was an incredible life experience for me to work in a jail. And
what was your position?
I was just a correction officer. At an entry level, I took the civil service test, and Sheriff Amato appointed me.
But you needed to be physically fit.
Well, physically fit, and you had to pass the civil service exam. And, and I did that. I was fortunate enough. I came in second, so I was reachable on the list, and they put me in there. And
For county level?
Yeah.
And
it was out in Montgomery County. I didn't want to be in the Schenectady County.
No, but people still recognized you in Montgomery County.
I remember
because they took Schenectady inmates.
Yes.
People from Schenectady, they took in Montgomery County.
Because Montgomery County accepted federal inmates. Schenectady did not. So whenever the U.S. Marshals or the FBI had a drug raid in Schenectady, a lot of the people that they picked up, they'd ship them out to Montgomery
County.
And
somehow they knew you.
They did, because, I knew their families. And I'll never forget, there was one kid, he was 22 years old. And I looked at, I'm not going to say his grandfather's name.
Okay.
But I said, I knew your grandfather. Mm-hmm. He's looking at me. And I said, he's a nice guy. And I said, I remember he told me something when I was your age, or a little bit older. He said, remember those on your way up, because they're the same ones you're going to see on your way down. And the kid looked at me, and I was kind of playing with his head a little bit, because I said, now your grandfather, he passed away about 4 years ago, right? Yeah. He says, yeah. And I says, he was a good man. I said, I'm sure he wouldn't be happy mm-hmm. knowing that you're incarcerated, so. But I tried to be fair with everybody, and it was a wonderful experience, because I found out, just because somebody's an inmate, some of them definitely deserve to be there. Some of them are there because they made stupid decisions. And you know what? We've all made stupid decisions. I used to joke around with the other COs in our break room. And I used to say, something? There's a fine line between correction officer and inmate. I said, you got to be a little crazy to want to work here.
So just quickly, yes or no, are you in favor of raise the age?
Raise the age
of 16, criminal responsibility.
16, 17 years old, or just all juveniles, even though they do real felonies.
Are you following that?
Yeah, not really, but okay. but
that's really so the that's point.
Let me just. 18 years old, you could go and go in the military then, and I think they had a special section for kids that were 16 years old.
Really?
Yeah, they'd be behind glass, and you had to keep them separated. That was and those 16 year olds, what a pain in the neck they were.
So I just wanted to also extend our condolences, because earlier this year you lost your mom.
Yes, I did.
And it was at the beginning, at the turn.
January 2nd.
So our condolences.
Thank you. Thank you. She was a great lady.
May her memory be a blessing.
Yes, and my dad passed away in 99. Shortly thereafter, my mom would say, I'm ready to join your father. And then she'd say, good Lord, come and get me. I'm ready. Mm. And
but 18 years later.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you never know your time.
Well, only good times ahead, and much success to you.
Thank you very much. It was great seeing.
Thanks for sharing your memories with us.
My
and
pleasure.
You should only have good memories for the
Thank
future.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.